Okay, good afternoon. We will talk today mostly as non-economists and members of the Sustainable Finance Lab, as you just mentioned, which is an initiative which was taken in 2010 and which was kind of a response to the financial crisis and was an effort to mobilize professors in economic science in the Netherlands to rethink the economic system and particularly the role of finance in the economic system. So we were then the ones who said, based on our background, that making a model, a formal model, can discipline your thinking. So it's not that we claim that the model is somehow the real world. We do not claim that the model is used to predict the future. We basically say that the model is a way to explicitize and discipline the thinking about some of the basic mechanisms in this extremely complex system called the economy. So we will say a few things about this model which we made, but the discussion on the model is minor. Then, as part of the discussion, we will talk about things like non-equilibrium aspects of the model. And we also will, in some detail, describe the submodels. But before I go into this model, I want to show you two slides which I usually use in my course on integrated sustainable development, which is that the economic system, and I always want to tell this, teach this particularly to economists, the economic system is really part of a larger system called the Earth. And the Earth has incoming solar energy, which is then dissipated and partly sent out again, radiated out again, as low temperature waste heat. And basically, everything we do in the economic system is part of this driving natural system. And if you then focus a little bit more, you realize that much of what we call the economy then is kind of accounting in financial terms of particularly industrial production, but also commercial services. And there is also this financial system, which has become more and more important because of financialization in what we call the formal monetary economy. But you should realize that if you look at the whole world population of 8 billion people, almost, we have subsistence economies, people who join not the formal economy, simply because they grow their stuff, eat it or trade it without money. We have ecosystem services. Economists now try to monetize those. But you have to be careful here. It's part of the system, but whether you can really express it sensibly in monetary terms is an open question. And then you have all the things which are part of, you might say, the informal economy, all the volunteers, the shadow economy. So from this Earth, we're already down, if we bring down the economy, to a minor part of what really matters for us. And that's what I wanted to point out at the beginning of my talk. Now, this tremendous simplification is, by me now, condensed into the basic model which we start with, which is the neoclassical growth model. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this model. Some of you are. A little bit. Well, it's an extremely powerful mental image of what happens in the economy. First, around beginning 20th century, land was taken out of the economic production function. Why? Because land was no longer as important as it used to be in the 19th century. The key production functions became, with industrialization, capital and labor. So the key production function is some description in which capital and labor generate output. There's a huge debate for the last 100 years whether this is sensible at all to have one parameter called capital and one parameter called labor. if you buy this for the moment, then the key thing in those production functions is that capital and labor can be substitutes. And we all know this, because that's what happened the last 100 years. Labor was complemented with capital. The farmer got a tractor, the weaver got a textile machine, etc. So what happened is that the capital labor ratio went up, and this is, in all our economic thinking, the driving force behind our increasing welfare. It's the growth in labor productivity. And if you do this, and the guy who was most famous here is Solo in the 50s, you discover that substitution between capital and labor can explain about one third of economic growth. So, what else? What is explaining the two-thirds of economic growth? Well, economists have a fairly easy answer. It's an exogenous factor called total factor productivity, which is exponentially growing. And this is the main reason why in all the economic projections you will see exponential growth, because it's simply put into the exogenous factor with maybe some minor modifications like endogenous learning. But basically, if you see an economic projection of exponential growth, it's this external function which is generating it. And it's like a deus ex machina, because after all, you hope it works that way, because it did work that way in the past. So if you go into the equation, you get, for example, this very elementary growth equation. I will not go into any details, just one remark. If you follow this model, it has diminishing capital productivity, which means that at some point, adding more capital is hardly adding more output, which means that this model has naturally the tendency to go to a steady state. So why worry about limits to growth? Yes? I mean, limits to growth is part of this model, because the model will automatically go to a steady state, unless you have this exponential growth, which generates much productivity rise and therefore generates economic GDP growth. So it's an interesting discussion. Now, what we did is take this model and then make in software, in this case VenSim, but you can also use Stella or other packages. We make a dynamic simulation, and I only show you this one to give you an idea. What you do is you look at stocks, which are capital and population or labor. Those stocks are part of the production function, which generates physical output. The physical output then is what you want, and it is generated partly with a fixed savings rate. That means that part of your output is taken apart and used for investments in capital and replacement of depreciated capital. So in fact, the main feedback loop here is that you produce output and part of it goes replacing existing capital stocks, and part of it goes to addition with new capital stock. This is the whole story. I mean, you can make many refinements. Savings rate becomes a function of income. TFP, exogenous function, can be high, low, etc. But this is the most elementary model. And I mean, those of you who want to experiment with it, VenSim is freely available, and we can send you the model. So it's really basic stuff. Of course, we then started to make a number of improvements, which I will not say too much about. You can make incremental improvements, and many economists play this with, for example, more sectors. Yes, manufacturing and services, government, etc. You can make, interestingly also, a non-homogeneous production function, which means that you have a production function in which you have not capital productivity going to zero. And then you have actually an economy with some of the features of high-tech computer stuff, where you have capital productivity rising on and on. And that's an interesting debate. I will just skip it here. The most important part for us in relation to finance is this. And this was a famous statement where he quotes Keynes, because Keynes, a famous economist, already said in the 30s that the whole idea of this basic model, that the savings from the output go directly into the investments of the capital stock, is just not true. Because in between you have investors, and investors have behavior. And that behavior means that they, for example, look for future production expectations, or they look for risks, or they look for costs. So this is not true. Planned investment need not equal planned saving, a central feature of the Keynesian position. So we started to have a number of improvements and extensions in our model. And the essence is that we put a simulation of the financial system, as we'll explain in more detail by class, between investments and savings. So you have now, on the one hand, all the consumers who consume but also save money on accounts. On the other hand, you have, and in between our banks and the financial system, on the other hand, you have the people who want to have credit to invest in business. And what we do then is that we make, for example, explicit distinction between physical and monetary stocks and flows. We introduce a disequilibrium between supply and demand. So we do not have the immediate equilibration, which is in most economic models. So you get already delays, which create oscillations. We also, as I said, have this more advanced investment function. So investors are really now looking at the marginal productivity of capital and labor, and then decide how much they want to invest. So they do not base their investment decisions on the amount of money you were saving as consumers. That's all nonsense. It was told to us for a very long time, but it's just not true. And consumer behavior is also, in our model, more explicit, because we have different categories. And the reason is that some people have lots of money and use it, for example, as bonds or shares or other purposes. But other people are actually poor and become more and more loaded with debt. And those consumer categories have to be distinguished to make a sensible model. So I go fast here, but just to give you a feel for things which will show up later, this is the kind of curves we then produce with the model. And what I'm saying here is, this, for example, is a typical initialization problem. You have to accept this kind of thing in a complex model. And secondly, these curves are basically calibration. That means that you have the model, you think you have a few, let's say, sensible descriptions of what's going on in the real world, and then you play with the parameters in such a way that they reproduce some of your proxy empirical variables. Those of you who do statistical work will certainly understand what I'm talking about. So this is then the reproduced physical output for the EU, associated prices. Prices times output gives you the GDP. So this is GDP in the EU as we simulate it. Employment ratio, wage level, this kind of variables are in the system, in the model system. Now, just to not disqualify our work, but tell you how complex it is, these are some numbers about the economy in the EU. And just to show you, this is the stuff which is produced in the economy, and this is the stuff which is consumed. Now, this is relatively simple. We all know this, what we consume. But if you look at what we make, then you realize that the normal stuff which we talk about, if we talk about production, is only 1/3, which is agricultural industry. Much of our GDP is much more complex kind of production. It is, for example, public administration, health, science here at universities, insurance, real estate, retail. So only a small part of our economy is really the kind of manufacturing we are thinking of if we talk about the economy. In fact, we have a service economy in Europe, and 70%, about 70% of our GDP is from such services. And secondly, much of those services are deeply connected with the government, who collects taxes and then finances, for instance, large parts of these services, like universities, and secondly, do a lot of redistribution. You can imagine that we are not able to simulate in a relatively simple model the full complexity of what's going on here. So we have to really reduce this description, and what we do then is focus on the financial system and say, okay, if this is our objective, then what are the features in this system? And there was a report by De Weijer and some other people who unequivocally concluded from an analysis that if you look at the history, that there is a long uptrend in the ratio of debt to income. So what we do know about the Western world is that we, or basically our banks, have indebted us more and more to an astonishing amount. The driving mechanism is the rising role of private debt as a source of money creation, and this has been driven by the dominance of bank money. And this is typically what our talk is about, because this is the essence of financialization. And what it means is, for example, nicely described by Dirk Bezemer, a colleague of ours, where he says these are the stocks of outstanding credit in mortgages, and what turns out to be that banks have shifted their banking model, their business model, from providing credit to business to, for a large extent, providing credit to households for mortgages. So they are now indebting us as citizens, as consumers, more than indebting the businesses in the real economy. And this is a major shift which has worked out by Dirk Bezemer in much of his academic work. Another part, and I go fast here, I realize, is that we also know from a number of studies that there are in this financialization system a number of incentives for some people to become very rich at the expense of others. And that's particularly the loop which has to do with the bonus loop, which means that certain people know how to play the game with money creation and then become a fund manager and take 5 or 10% of all those flows. Even if you take 1%, you become already a billionaire. We have the defaulting loop, which we will talk about in more detail in the next story. And we have the political pressure loop. The default loop is you indebt also poor people. And at some point, if they lose their job, they can no longer pay you back. They're defaulting. Consequence, banking crisis. The political pressure loop is I want to consume, so the government should help me to have cheap credit, otherwise I cannot buy a house. So, for instance, you start then to say to people, okay, if you have a big debt, we will relieve your tax pressure. This is what we do in the Netherlands. So the point here is now, you will take over class, that this is the essence of our model. The next part coming now, which is, what is this financial system between, let's say, our savings and consumption on the one hand, and those guys who do financial stuff on the other. Yes, yes, sorry. I hope it works.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, now come up here.
Let's start.
Okay.
Yeah. What you're seeing here is a group of actors from Amsterdam called the Different Leiders. Maybe you know it. 10 years ago they had a play called Door de Bank Genomen, taken over by the bank. And it was about the whole the financial system. That generated a lot of societal unrest. And finally, also from the foundation, Our Money, Ons Geld, we had the initiative from all these people having their signature under a paper, driven by this play, to have a discussion in parliament about the financial system. Finally, that went up to a report of the WRR, Scientific Council, about money and debts. And the Minister of Finance, Wopke Hoekstra, well known, just has thrown it in the garbage box while we were standing there. So that was 10 years ago, and now they have a new try in which there is also a lady in the bank. You can see she's looking quite serious. Well, this just 10 days ago in Amsterdam, premiere, first performance, and a new try to have this on the agenda. Okay, this is the ECB, of course. We did our work, Bert was talking about, for the Eurozone, discussing the whole Euro thing. This is Lagarde, of course, and this is our Klaas Knot from the National Central Bank. You might say that the national, the current national banks, central banks, are a part of the framework of the European banks in Europe, directed by Mrs. Lagarde. Okay. This is the bank balance sheet for Bert promised that I would talk about the financial system, which then included into the next doors to the economic system. And that we've done by assuming that there is that financial system can be represented by a single bank. That's not that may be argued from the fact that all these things are behaving in the same way. So when you have 10 banks, they are all behaving more or less in the same manner. And the second thing is that we only have in the Netherlands 3 big banks, you know, who are playing the whole game. And there is now going on a fusion of all sorts of banks. We have the Credit Suisse and the UBS affair this week, in the United States as well. These problems we have at this very moment are just resulting in a further concentration of banks. Nevertheless, the whole idea was, and that is important, that you have on this bank balance sheet, there is on the left-hand side, which is called assets, and the right side is called liabilities. These are loans. The bank is giving you a loan, for example, for a house or mortgage. And the whole idea was, up till the 70s, that then there is money from savers. So I'm saving, I'm a little bit older, as you know, as you can see. I'm saving a little bit money, and the bank is giving my money to a student from the university over here to buy a house when he has finished his study. And that was that was real money from my side that's going to the loan for somebody else. And the bank was just managing that and having some provision for the work and risk they were taking. But that is an old story. The story nowadays is that this has nothing to do, is our statement, with what's happening over there. For if the bank is giving you a mortgage, then they are not bothering too much or not at all about the money they have on their deposits from people like me. They are just looking at you and saying, okay, you are able to pay such amount of money, and they are giving you the mortgage out of nothing. I don't know whether you are familiar with the simple story. It's frightening simple. How money is created? Do you know that, or shall I have a few words on it? A few words. This is again the same bank balance sheet. There are assets on the left-hand side and deposits. So my money as a citizen is somewhere here. I'm a plus consumer in our model. That was a little bit richer consumer, and my money is here. with a certain amount in that deposit with the bank. On the left-hand side, there are people who have mortgages, etc. Now, there is the young guy, and he wants to buy a house in Nijmegen, for example. And there is and he needs this amount of money. It's 1 million euros. That's quite a lot for Nijmegen, maybe. But say it's Amsterdam on the canals. And there is this old lady who is selling their house. And then the bank is just making this money out of nesting. So on this side of the balance sheet, there is plus 1 million euros. And on that other side, also plus 1 million billion. So the big wonder is here that, or the big miracle, is that on both sides of the bank balance sheet, there is plus 1 million. So the balance is maintained. And that's a big miracle, of course. And then we are saying that the bank balance sheet is elongated. It's become longer. And that means that there is more money in the system. Four, this money is giving to the guy over here. He is giving it to the old lady selling her house. She is making a cruise around the world. So that money is real money, which is spent all over the globe. It's real existing money created out of nothing. And then so she's taking the money and going embarking on the ship. And then the guy has to pay for 30 years that amount of money back to the bank. And the bank is expected to destroy that money. For it's created out of nothing. That's the reason why these bankers are saying that they are doing God's work, by the way. And when the money is paid back, they have to destroy it. It's not fully sure if that's really done, but okay, for the time being, we assume that it's happening. And given the fact that this process is far more dominating, the creation process over the destruction process, there's an increasing amount of money in the system. And that is the story of what's happening over here. Okay. Now, this is these are a few understandings that the first thing is that Bert also talked about that there is the Minsky affair, that there are risks taken. They might be too high, and that will give this instability in the bank, for the banks to take it. That the Silicon Survey Bank, the interest rate is going up. Their government bonds they have on there are decreasing in value, and the bank is bankrupt. And that is then a risk, of course. Another risk is Minsky Plus, and that's the most important mechanism in our model. That is that's based on the previous sheet, and that's happening in 2008 at the crisis. Then these housing prices are going too high, also in Europe. Then there is a level in which these people cannot pay any longer the cost of the mortgage, the repay and the rent cost of rent interest rates. And then they are defaulting on their loans, and the bank then is going bankrupt. The bank has a certain 5% or so on core money, which is used to compensate for the losses from this not repaying people. But when it's going over 5%, for example, then there is a shortage of money, and the bank is formally bankrupt.
Just to add one thing, this is important because the notion of instability was at the beginning of our modeling effort. Because if you look at sustainable development, we all know that uncertainty and instability may actually push people into short-term thinking. So it's if this system is really unstable for two reasons, which are well described in the literature, the Minsky studies from the 80s are well known. About bust and boom. So these two mechanisms were so important for us because they could possibly explain why the system is inherently unstable.
Yeah. That's an important point. Our claim is, there's not everybody's convinced about that the system is fundamentally unstable. Given the fact that it's pro-cyclic, that there are positive feedbacks, Bert already showed a little bit in that model frame, something which is going up faster. Something which is going down faster. So when there is a short disruption, it's running out of the way on the left or the right hand side of the road, and it will collapse. So this is the fundamental core of the whole thing, a pro-cyclic system which is inherently unstable. And that's the Minsky story. Now, this is the 2008 crisis, of course. No one, there are many publications written down there, and they all have the title, No One Saw This Coming. Economists claiming that it could not be foreseen. There were a few who did. For example, Rogoff, he's a very famous one. And another famous one is our Dirk Bezeming in Groningen, who also has warned that this was going to happen. For Dirk, as Bert told you already, it was studying the whole fact that all these investments are shifting from real economic investments on capital formation for production purposes to asset purposes, from machinery to housing. And that was the big reason, the big failure of 2008. Now, in the ECB affair we have, then after the crisis, there's an austerity program. So they are also in this country, about 80 billion has been spent on saving of banks. For example, ABN AMRO has to be bought by the Dutch government by about 30 billion euros. It's still not paid back, or it's still, we have about 10, 12 billion shares of that bank at this very moment. So there was a lot of expenses from the government. For in that case, the idea was that the government, this is a private affair, it's going wrong, and the government has to save this banking system in favor of citizens. Then there's an austerity program, and we all have to repay, and the whole thing is getting under stress, the whole economic system. So that is the period after 2008. Then they decide to are going to stimulate the economy by pressing the interest rate down. That can be done by the central bank. That's called the policy interest rate. Then they are just declaring, as happening now the other way around, to a low level. And when the interest is low, investment is cheap, so you can make many investments and produce a lot of things, stimulate the economy. Playing with the interest rate, this policy interest rate, is the instrument central banks can use to control the economy. But there's a lot of debate going on for decades that this instrument is not really working. When you look at the statistics of these movements of this policy interest rate, it's not convincing that it worked anyhow. Nevertheless, they tried, so we had a negative interest rate for many years. On the right-hand side, you see the inflation rate, the change in the price level, and it should be about 2%. Oh, you can't see it. Sorry, it's 2% is over here. This level, and it went to about 1%. And the ECB has a targeted inflation rate by its mandate to be 2% inflation every year. And Draghi, you remember that, was saying, okay, we are not able to have the 2%, it's only 1%, so we have to throw money into the system. That was a new instrument they were using, called quantitative easing. By throwing money in the system, you might hope that the inflation is going up. For the production remains the same, more money in the system, prices will go up. And that's what they were up to. So that was then done. And that's called quantitative easing. A little bit later we will continue on that. This is the model as we are using it at this moment. This is the economic part Bert told you about. And on the right-hand side we have that, by now well-known, bank balance sheet, which is representing the financial part of the whole thing. And you should understand that this economic part, where you have the production function Bert was still telling about, we have capital, labor, we have here markets, where we have the meeting of demand of goods and production of goods for three sectors, a manufacturer sector, mainly physical, a service sector, and a government. They are producing things, goods and services, and there's a price mechanism. The price is here made by clearing the markets in this sector. Wages is also determined by market mechanism. There is a supply of labor, which is given by the amount of people, and there is a call for labor, and this determines then the wage level. Then there is a mechanism which describes the asset price, which is very important in the model, and that's dependent on financial markets. for in a literature, we know from all sorts of studies on the subject that when there is more liquidity in the system, prices will go up. Also, when banks are giving more mortgages, then it's also stimulating the increase of mortgage levels. So if everybody is thinking, okay, banks are giving mortgages, as a consequence of that, the price of housing is going up. That's a stimulating thing for other people to buy houses or buy speculators. And that is a very positive feedback. It's increasing, so everybody's going there, and it increases more. Positive feedback. And that is very important over here. So this is the economic part, and that's only used only to inform the mutations, the changes in this accounting system on the right-hand side. So it gives all sorts of movements of money from four groups of consumers over here, firms which are making the investments over there. We have the government, private banks, and the central bank, and all this money, taxation, you can see over here. These people, the government is indebted, for example, by saving banks, and they are just emitting government bonds on a huge scale, and that's paid by these richer consumers, for example. We are thinking that these two richer consumers categories represent the financial markets, liquidity, free money available, and in doing so, this whole game is played, and we are trying to simulate what's going on in the combination of the economy, the real economy, and the financial accounting system. Now, maybe we skip this for the moment. This is just an whole debate. We can come back to it under the discussion. Of course, you have all sorts of assumptions in there. What is the consumption function? How many of their income is used for consumption? Is it depending only on your income or only on your wealth level? All these things are there based on literature mainly. Important to know that there are four groups of consumers. These consumers are non-saving. They are spending all their money, all their income on living. These are indebted consumers, which are the group of having mortgages, for example. So they're spending all their money on their living and on paying back the mortgage and the interest rate on the mortgage. And these are the consumers who are having their income from labor and from bonds. They are dealing with government bonds, buying, selling. And the same holds for this group, labor, bonds, and shares. And they are buying shares from firms, and they are getting dividend from firms. So that's how it works. Now, this is then the important loop for the asset price. The asset price, as I told you, is driven by liquidity available and by bank loans given. This is coming from literature. The asset price is modeled in that way, and it can be nicely done, I think. And the whole idea now is that when the residential quote, and that is the ratio between the costs of the mortgage in relation to the net income. So when that's going over 50%, the idea is that these people are not able anymore to repay the mortgage. And they are saying to the bank, sorry, I cannot repay it. And the bank then has to take their loss. The house will be sold, hopefully at a higher price, but maybe at a lower one. Nevertheless, what we are assuming that when this happens, the only thing in the model, the only thing is that we assume that the number of asset transactions, verkoop van huizen, is decreasing from the usual 5% to 3%. And when that happens, the only thing that happens. Then there are the total amount of money which is flowing into the system by giving new mortgages, new money creation out of nothing, is decreasing. So the total liquidity in the system is decreasing relatively. And the asset price is going up more slowly or even going down. And when this is going down, then there, of course, is new equilibrium. But in most cases, the asset price is going down that much that the damage done, the amount of money which cannot be repaid is larger than the amount of money banks have in their own bank system, 5%, as the core money for taking the risk. Then they are losing 10% of their overall loans, and they have 5% in-house in their equity, and then they are bankrupt. And then the government, and you can see here, then this defaulting occurs, bank equity is lost, house prices are going down, these houses lost their value, even more problems for these banks, and then the banks have to recapitalize these, the government has to recapitalize these banks. And then is the question, who pays? Up till now, the taxpayer is paying the bill, and the bill is huge, as you have seen. This week, last week in the United States, with the Silicon Valley Bank, also the taxpayers are paying. In the United States, it's a little bit more complicated with the Fed instead of the ECB. We have in Europe, the whole idea is that there is a debt guarantee system for these banks. So the first 100,000 euros in for example in Europe is guaranteed. That is paid by the banks, but also by the taxpayers already. In the United States, they have now paid all the losses, also far over $100,000. So the average loss was $4 million in the Silicon Valley Bank last week. And that's also paid by the government to save that banking system over there. So the conclusion is, up till now, in the next crisis, we again will pay all together as taxpayers all these enormous losses, which finally, after all, stem from this pro-cyclic mechanism that the risks are going out of control, given the fact that banks are making more money at the wrong moment when asset prices go up. For then it's most profitable for them to do so, and that is completely wrong. They have to, and that's the whole clue of our proposal, and that's not new, but that's the clue, that you should make the money on the moment that the prices are going down. But banks are not doing that. When prices are going down, banks stop creating money. And then it becomes worse. With the government, when the government is making the money, they are making it when the prices are going down, and when prices are going up, they just don't make money from the government part of side. So the fact that banks have their profits by means of this money creation, they're doing it at the wrong moment, and they are provoking crisis. So there is the fundamental misfit in the system. This is the level of the ratio between the costs of mortgages and the net income. And it's going over 0.5, but you might argue it's 0.6. This comes from empirical facts from Portugal. Then the number of transactions is going down, Minsky moment, and defaulting. Well, a few results then. This is the reconstruction, the model reconstruction of 100 years. It's quite an ambition. From the 1950, the first 20 years is, as Bert told you, more or less used as an initialization of the model. It's here over 2050. This is the 2008 crisis. The whole thing is this collapsing over here. And then the same mechanism is still in place, which is truly the fact. All these debates of 2008 have been of non-value at the end of the day. So the whole thing is going up again, and the model then predicts, but that's no prediction, it's quite arbitrary, but some moment in the future, the same story will repeat itself, nothing's changed, and then again a next crisis over there. This is the situation in which would have been the case without this QE program of the European Union, of the ECB. The QE program that was given by the picture over here. They inserted, during that period, after the first crisis, 2008, they inserted these 5,000 billion euros. They intended to insert 8,000. That was done for two reasons. First thing was that Italy was in problems, and Greece. The big question was, why not helping then Italy and Greece? You can pay it from out of your pocket. It's not too much money. But Draghi said, it was forbidden in those days for the ECB and for the European Union to save a single country. So the answer was that they have to buy given the fact that these state obligations, bonds, were decreasing for Italy and for Greece, and they decided to buy these bonds to keep the prices up, but not only for Italy and Greece, for the whole of Europe. Though, so they started with this 8,000 billion euros to buy bonds also from the Netherlands and from Germany and from France. And that money that was all discussed, that came in the financial markets and did not reach the real economy. So that money has spent for nothing, actually. Okay, what happens then is that the real development, as modeled, is given by this curve. So this, what you can see here, that is the increase, that is a price effect, inflation effect, from this inserted money over here. And we can see it a little bit better when we are looking at... Okay, no, sorry, this I have to tell you now for technical reasons on this sheet already. So we are looking what happened with the central bank. We are looking what their answer has been by this QE. We also are looking what their answer has been or is now going to be called QT, quantitative tightening. So they are not relaxing the system with putting more money in it. They are just tightening it by having the interest rate going up. That means that the incentive to spend money in new investment is lowered. So the whole system then is cooled down, the whole economy. And that's then to cool down the inflation, which is now quite high, as you know, 5%. But let's have a look on this line over here. This is the alternative, and we have made only one change, and that is that not the private banks are creating the money which is needed in an economy, but the government is doing it. That's to say, the ECB on behalf of the European government. And they're making the money, as we discussed, on the right moment. When prices are going down, they are making the money. When prices are going up, they are not making money. They retrieve money as possible via selling of bonds, taking money out of the system, or increasing taxation. Taxation and money creation are both movements from the same body, supplying money into the system or retrieving money from it. And that is done over here. And then you can see this green line. That is what we are calling central bank created currency. And that reminds you maybe on central bank digital currency, which is the idea that the euro actually is a cryptovaluta, just like the Bitcoin. It's made by private organizations out of control of the government. So that's just the Bitcoin, our euro actually. And when the central bank again is going to be the creator of real central bank money, which can be owned in society, then the whole problem is solved, for that money is completely safe. When there is a bank run or no, or whatever happens, a world war might happen, and your money remains your money, just like in the cadastral registration of your house, if you have one, it's saying that you are the owner of this so many square meters, and that's an ownership which is independent of all sorts of private operations. And your bank money is not your money. It's only a claim on the real money. And when we would go back to the real money made by the central bank, all these problems are over. And the big advantage, it can be produced on the right moment in time. And that's called here in this model CBCC. This is the inflation which happened. You can see here, this is the QE program, inserting money in the system. And then they started already here. There's something wrong. The idea is that there is an inflation over here. The whole clue is that the response of the system to this inserted money was very late. So what happened? They are starting to throw money in the system from 2010 onwards. Nothing happens. Draghi decides whatever it takes, and he's throwing more money in the system. And that's going on for 10 years, more and more money. And the inflation rate is just staying at a lousy 1%. And he wants it to be 2%. And suddenly, also without the Ukrainian war and the increase in energy price, we expected in the model that this amount of money is becoming available in the real economy with a delay. For what has been done is that the money is sent, is inserted into the financial markets. They are buying bonds from all sorts of investors, Blackstones and all these private equity firms. They are having the money. They are buying real assets, whole parts of cities here in the Netherlands where have been bought, or land or whatever, as investments. That was not in the real economy. It was just in the assets domain. So it did not reach the real economy, so there was no inflation effect at all. Only later, when this money slowly is diffusing into the real economy, you have this effect over here. So it's too late. This is the response of this moment. The central bank then is, now we have they are surprised by the inflation rate we have in a model of 5-6%, which is corresponding to the real inflation rate outside. They have increased the policy interest rate by certain percentages. It was negative all over the time, as you saw in one of the previous sheets, and now they are stepwise increasing it in an extremely fast rate to 4%, more or less. In the model we have, it's more sensitive. For the problem is that the central bank reserve policy rate is affecting only part of the economy, and we are assuming in the model that it's affecting the whole system in one time. So that's a difference. But nevertheless, we can study these effects of increasing the policy interest rate. When it's going up, investment will go down, and the whole economy will cool down. And that can be seen here. We'll discuss it later. These two curves, the blue one is a policy interest rate of plus 0.5%, and the red one, 1%. And you can see this is then the expectation of the inflation, which is indeed cooling down. So that might be then effective in terms of this model. When you are going too high in this increasing interest rate, it will be, again, a very negative, it's an overshoot, a negative inflation called deflation again. So it's quite difficult, is the message of this picture, to control the system by this interest rate, just as many authors and literature are saying, telling us the last 30 years. In our model, it looks like a commercial, I realize, then there is, after some adaptation, there is a flat line of a 2% targeted inflation rate. For the model is deciding that it has to generate more money when the prices are going down, and vice versa. And that works very fine, is the idea. These are a few more examples. This is the total amount of money in the system, called M3. And, this is all created money for exactly the last part over here, since the 80s, more or less, is all created by private banks. And this is the story including the QE. So then this is the amount of money which is inserted by the QE program, 5,000 billion. And here we have the... This is the same story for the CBCC, our ideal modeled governmental money creation. And these are data which is more or less following this line. You can see for us also a huge question, by the way. We are assuming that there is money destroyed during the crisis. But in the empirical data, you don't see anything of it. So that's something we don't understand either, what's going on there. They say they are destroying money. We as taxpayers have paid a huge amount to save banks, and that no money is disappearing at all. Strange. Nevertheless, another example, the asset price we discussed. This is the asset price modeled for the non-QE. And when you have this QE affair, the only thing you are achieving is a higher price of assets. That's also coming from the fact that all this money which is going in there is spent by these Blackstones and private equity firms, as I told you, in real assets. Not affecting the real economy, not producing the targeted inflation rate. This is again the model. You can see that in the CBCC, governmental created money, then there is a far more moderate development of the price. You might think taxation is going up. In the other normal cases, this is the taxation level, and in the ideal modeled case of CBCC, then taxation is also very low. So you should realize that there is also a bonus to the whole thing. When you are creating this money, the government could spend that money on all sorts of things. I will show you that a little bit later. This is the conclusion. The ECB seems to be unable to control the target level of 2%. The QE program is too indirect. The money is going to financial markets and staying there. Commercial banks via this TLTRO bank reserve system. Then they said, give cheap money to banks, hoping that they were spending it on small business firms, etc. The banks did not, so it didn't work either. The QT program we are facing now, the last 3-4 weeks, increasing the policy interest rate to up to 4% might work. It's contested by many scientists. And it's producing at least instability over here. And what should be done, that's our answer to the whole question. The interest rate is a nice thing to control the whole affair. Or throwing money to the financial markets. But what should be done is controlling the money in the real economy. But that is forbidden in the Maastricht Treaty of 1992. Then there is an article 104, I think, saying that it's forbidden to create money for public purposes. So banks are making money out of nothing. They are spending it. They are taking risks. And when it's going wrong, taxpayers paying huge bills, 80 billion in this country already. The idea since Aristotle that the community, the government, is making its own money for its own purpose and philosophy is forbidden. We are the only continent in the world, the only central bank who has this problem that it's forbidden to create money for our own public purposes. So that is the problem we are demonstrating here, we hope. So when we would change the Maastricht Treaty and we were able to say, ECB, you are allowed to produce money and to produce this 2% targeted inflation rate, then the whole problem would be solved. And actually, the only thing we are doing then is going from a pro-cyclic, unstable system to an anti-cyclic system, which is inherently stable, producing the money at the right moment. And then is, of course, the central bank digital currency, that also in a later stage, the central bank is making money rather than private banks. That will be a big bonus. For then, when we are producing 2% a year, then that money can be spent by us. I hope that, no, that's not here. Sorry, that's not in here. I stole too many sheets away. When you're looking at the government debt, this system also has one controlling factor, and that is the inflation rate. And when we are running this model, it's going to repay also this enormous amount of government debt, which is about in Netherlands 60% of GDP, and in Europe 100% of GDP. So 100% of GDP, that's 14,000 billion euros, is going to be printed by mevrouw Lagarde, and she is paying back all these bondholders in Europe as long as she is staying on the 2% inflation level, and that's possible. So we are able to repay, when we are changing the system according to this proposal, to repay all the debts we have in Europe. And then that is a big bonus, for there's no need to repay every year these bonds and paying the interest, which is now again 5%. And as you know, that for the Netherlands, it's already 9 billion euros we have to pay every year, given the increased interest rates on these outstanding debts we have as a community. So there's a big bonus in there. And after this 20 years that the whole government debt is repaid, then there is a more or less rule of thumb that you can spend at least 2% of the GDP by making new money to produce this inflation rate of 2%. 2% of 14,000 billion euros is, well, 300-400 billion, and that can be spent every year for free by the community on you name it. The European Parliament can say we're spending it on the Green Deal of Frans Timmermans, for example. And that then has not to be paid by taxpayers. So apart from the stability affair, there's also a big bonus in overall spending. This is a small epilogue, the 5 minutes to for this epilogue. We discussed that during lunch, and maybe it makes sense if you are not too confused by this all, to zoom out a little bit. For the problem is that, as Fred Jong is saying, that the most people are zooming in and too less people are zooming out. There's an attempt to zoom out a little bit. And the question might be, how did we come along this whole affair anyhow? And when you are discussing sustainability, this, by the way, was Aristotle, Plato on the left-hand side, Aristotle on the right-hand side. After all, it's an idea of what is a good life. How can we understand that it's going wrong every now and then, or time and again, I have to say. This is the result of many things, but one of the things is a survey which we made on value orientation in the Netherlands in 2004, on request of the Secretary of State. This graph is saying that people are more oriented on materialist values on the lower side, or non-materialist at the upper side. These people are reading books. These people are driving cars, for example. This is an orientation on the individual ego. Nothing wrong with that. And an orientation more on the community. You might have here an egocentric orientation, and here you have people who are saying on television, I saw them lately, saying that I think what Ajax thinks. So that's the psychology, and you can read Erich Fromm on it, the fear of freedom, for example, that people are, it's to experience your freedom is responsibility, etc., and awareness all the time, it's quite confusing and exhausting. So people tend, when they are, to quote Jung, Carl Gustav Jung, people are so insecure about themselves that they cling on everything which gives them some, how was it? That's the worldview orientation of people, and you can then have in this part, of course, the combination of individual and the materialist is the hedonist orientation. We have this at the very moment. When you are generalizing that, this is here the rationalist. It's the, on the left hand side. There's one uniform truth. That was the last 100 years, centuries, the case, with a material orientation. So this is enlightenment, more or less. On the upper left, you have religion. There's one truth, also in a religion, more spiritual orientation on the upper left-hand side. The church, they're dominating, and here, this is the small scale of Schumacher's Small is Beautiful world, where you have small communities with a spiritual orientation. Now, the last sheet, the history is more or less that what we are claiming is just a wandering through our worldview orientation, and we starting in early Christianity over here, in small scale communities with a diversity of opinions. It's just your belief system. Oh, it's interesting. Tell me, and then when we have 400, the church is starting with a one truth world. There's a one belief system dictated by the church, and that is then for a long time the case. In the Renaissance, for several reasons, there is this renaissance of the views of Plato, left-hand side earlier, and Aristotle on the right-hand side in terms of orientations. We are given secularization more or less in the middle between the spiritual orientation over there and the material over here. So there is a balance in human orientations, in values. And that is very fruitful in many from many points of view. This is ending with the 30 years of war in Europe. And then we are just starting again where we were in this counterclockwise movement. The universal state is appearing. We're getting the Stalinistic things, we're getting the fascist things. Remember that is also a very universal world in which there is one Reich, ein Volk, ein Reich, ein Führer, but that's all universal. And the problem we are facing now in the ecological sense is here after the Berlin Wall, more or less, the whole idea of a total materialist worldview, which is bringing about ecological crisis and the banking system. And now we are more or less in the meanwhile in this part of the dominating picture, where we have the combination of the individual value orientation and the material one, materialist. It's I directed, iPhones, iMac, ICMAC, all these kind of things. Here you have the banking system, where greed is good, so the morality is dominating in this part. And we also have here the ECB. And remember that all these banking systems have this Greek temple symbol in there, or in their buildings. And that's very logical, for it's just the opposite of the church orientation on the other side. So there is a the diagonal orientation in here. Now this is not the important at the parts. You have the fact that the truth on the left-hand side doesn't exist anymore. Postmodernism has brought us all the orientation on the right-hand side, where truth finding, which is an interaction between the left and the right, doesn't exist anymore. So we are now in this part of the picture. I'm here with Steve Bannon over there, but that's a separate story. What I wanted to say in this epilogue is that the whole idea of a banking system is the caricature, the obsession, the exaggeration of a value orientation which is in the lower right-hand side of our being, being physical, material, and individual. Nothing wrong with that. For we are free to take our positions in that value orientation, but exaggeration, time and again in history, means catastrophe. And the current catastrophe, is our thinking, is here. Thank you.